Students, today we are going to study about the compound eyes. In the previous lecture, we were studying about the sense organs, out of which I have already taught about the touch, taste, smell and hearing senses, which is basically because of the sensili, and this was the basic structure of the sensili. Now what we were left was the sight organ. They are the pair of compound eyes. And these are kidney shaped structure and they are located dorsolaterally on the head. They have a convex surface. This is the convex surface, which is covered with transparent cuticle, which is referred to as the cornea. And in case of insects, it is formed of many smaller subunits, which are called as ommatidia. And these ommatidia may be about 2000 in number. And each ommatidia is capable of forming the image. And hence, they are referred to as the compound eyes. These ommatidia are arranged radially and then they supply to the optic nerve which goes to the brain. This compound eye is basically formed of the two parts, the dioptric part and the receptive part. This dioptric part function is to gather and focus the light rays. It has at the outer end a transparent colorless, this structure is referred to as the corneal lens. It is hexagonal, it is biconvex, and it is transparent colorless part. It is the part of the cuticle that covers the eye. It is mainly protective in function. It is secreted by these two cells which lie just beneath this lens. These are referred to as the Cornegian cells. These Cornegian cells initially lie beneath the cornea cells, but later they shift to the sides of the ommatidium and form the iris pigment cells. Internal to the Cornegian cells is a tier of four cells. These tier are referred to as the cone cells. This is the cone cell. And it is formed of the four tiers of cells. The inner end of each cone cells becomes clear. This region of each cone cell becomes clear and refractive. And this results in the formation of a tapering rod crystalline cone. This is the crystalline cone. These are the cone cells. The crystalline cone acts as a lens. There is no mechanism for the accommodation because crystalline cone provides for a fixed focus. Then comes the receptive part. The receptive part receives the image and set up a nerve impulse. Here is the nerve fiber. It lies internal to the dioptric part and it consists of a tier of seven cells. This is the tier of seven cells. And the inner margins join to form. These cells are referred to as the retinal cells. Seven cells are referred to as the retinal cells. Here are the retinal pigment cells. Their inner end of the retinal cells differentiate to form the rhabdomere. This is the rhabdomere. And all the rhabdomeres together form a long refractile cone, which is referred to as the rhabdome. This is the rhabdome. It rests on the basement membrane. They pass through the basement membrane and then they end into a nerve fiber, which goes to the optic part of the optic nerve to the brain. And hence the image is formed. The crystalline cone focuses light rays on the rhabdome. The latter sets up a nerve impulse, which is carried to the brain by the optic nerve for perception. What happens is that there are two kind of images can be formed in case of the compound eyes, but in case of cockroach, it is always the opposition image or the mosaic image, because in cockroaches, these pigment, the iris, retinal pigment cells and these iris pigment cell, they are not retractable. Therefore, they see only the opposition image. But in case of compound eyes, two types of images can be observed. This is the opposition image. What happens is that in this case, when the light is very bright, these pigment cells, this is the iris pigment cell and this is the retina pigment cells, they cover the rhabdome. As a result, the light which is parallel to the rhabdome only enters the rhabdome and the image is formed by the light which is parallel to the rhabdome, which enters directly to the rhabdome. All other lights are absorbed by the pigments. This is being absorbed here, this is absorbed here. All the light gets absorbed, only the light which enters directly results into the formation of the image. And as a result, The rays which enters obliquely, they are absorbed, and the image is formed only by the light which enters parallel to the pigments. So the image is formed by several points of the light lying side by side, one in each omatidium. Such an image is called as apposition mosaic image, and the eye is referred to as the mosaic eye. During dim light, what happens is that these pigments are retracted. As a result, all of the light which are being obliquely, which falls obliquely on the surface of the cornea, also reaches the rhabdom. As a result, the image is formed by the overlapping light rays, and hence such image is referred to as a superimposition image. The special advantage of the compound eye is their ability to detect the movement of the objects. This superimposition image is sharp, but it is less sharp as compared to the apposition image, but it is very useful when the light is very dim, particularly in the night, to see the objects. Then comes the endocrine glands. In case of cockroach, there are four kinds of endocrine glands which are present. These are intercerebral gland cells. These intercerebral gland cells, as the name specifies, inter means between two cerebral regions of the brain. It is present between the two cerebral ganglion. They secrete the hormone which is referred to as the brain hormone. It activates the prothoracic glands to secrete their hormone. It also determines the rhythm of the activity. Basically, cockroaches are nocturnal animals. They are active during the night and dormant during the daytime. And then comes the corpora cardica. These are the pair of rod-like bodies which are situated on the sides of the esophagus. They secrete growth hormone, which helps in the growth of the cockroach. Then is corpora elata. These are pair of rounded bodies lying close behind the corpora cardica. They secrete juvenile hormone. Juvenile hormone in the nymphal stages, this is basically the hormone which maintains the nymphal characters and checks the appearance of the adult characters. Basically, it keeps the cockroach young, and therefore it is referred to as the juvenile hormone. In the last nymphal form, when the last molting occurs, the corpora elata becomes inactive and thereby resulting in the absence of juvenile hormone. And as a result, the adult character appears and the adult is formed. In adults, this corpora elata again become active, and when in adults it becomes active, it starts releasing the gonadotropic hormone, which helps in the controlling of the volatile sex attractants from the female, which act as chemoreceptors for the male antenna. They also helps in the development and the functioning of the accessory sex glands. Lastly, the endocrine gland which is present in the cockroach is prothoracic glands. Prothoracic glands are basically involved in the, they are situated in the prothorax region, which is the first region of the thorax. They secrete hormone which is referred to as ecdysone, and this helps in bringing about the molting of the nymphs. Next topic is the male reproductive system. Male reproductive system basically consists of a pair of testes, which is present in the fifth and the sixth abdominal terga, one on either side of the body. They are embedded in the fat bodies. They are formed of a number of small follicles. These are the follicles of the testicles. They produce the sperm or spermatozoa. Each follicle opens into vas deferenses, which then joins to form the vas deferenses. Vas deferenses are a pair of slender tubes. They first extend backward and then downward, and then open into the ejaculatory duct in the seventh segment. Ejaculatory duct is wide median duct. It has muscular wall and glandular epithelium. It is covered by the mushroom or articular gland. This is the mushroom or articular gland. Articular gland is large white gland interior to the ejaculatory duct. It is formed of three parts, the long tubules. These long tubules basically secretes the inner layer of the spermatophore wall. Small tubules, these are the small tubules. Their secretion nourishes the spermatozoa and the seminal vesicle. They form the posterior median part of the gland, and they store the sperms or spermatozoa. These are the three parts of the articular glands. Then comes the male genital aperture. This is the opening of the male genital aperture below the anus. It lies on the ventral phallomere. Gonopophyses or phallomeres are the irregular chitinous structures. These are the phallomeres. Left phallomere, ventral phallomere, and the right phallomere. These are basically the chitinous processes around the male genital aperture. They help in copulation, therefore they are the external genitalia. First is the right phallomere. Right phallomere basically has a two parts, a large serrate lobe, this which has teeth-like structures on one side, and this the other lobe, which is sickle-like lobe with a terminal hook. Then comes the left phallomere. Left phallomere is a large structure which has three arms. The largest arm is the tintillator, which has a hook on the one side. Then a pseudocerus, and then lastly is the aspirate lobe. Then comes the ventral phallomere. It is simple broad brownish plate. Male genital aperture lies at its end. Then is the phallic gland. This is the phallic gland and the phallic duct. It is interior to the articular gland. It lies beneath the ejaculatory duct and articular gland. Posteriorly, it tapers so as to form the duct, which is referred to as the phallic duct. And the secretion of this phallic duct forms the outer layer of the spermatophore wall. What happens is that these follicles results in the formation of the spermatozoa, which is then carried by the vas deferenses from vas efferences then to the vas deferenses into the seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles helps in the storage of the spermatozoa, and whenever there is act of copulation, these spermatozoa enters into the ejaculatory duct and they are expelled out of the body. While they enter into this genital chamber, the phallic duct secretion also meets here, and the outer layer of the spermatophore wall is also laid down here. The middle layer is released during the passage of the spermatozoa through the ejaculatory duct. And this is the spermatophore. Spermatophore is basically the structure which has the spermatozoa in the center and is covered by the three layers. The inner layer, which is secreted by the longer tubules of the articular gland. The middle layer, which is secreted by the ejaculatory duct, glandular part of the ejaculatory duct, and the outer layer, which is secreted by the phallic gland. Then comes the female reproductive system. Female reproductive system basically has a pair of ovaries. They lie beneath the 4th, 5th, and 6th abdominal turga. Each ovary consists of the ovarian tubules. These are the ovarian tubules or ovarioles, which are delicate transparent walls. The posterior end of the ovarian tubules is dilated and contains mature eggs. This is the posterior region of the ovary. They are dilated and contains the mature eggs, which gradually becomes tapered towards the interior. And they results in the formation of a terminal filament. They join collectively and form the terminal filament, thread-like filament. Here there are immature eggs, the young small eggs. Then comes the oviduct. All the ovarioles collectively form a common duct, which is referred to as the oviduct. Oviduct of both the sides join to form the common oviduct. Common oviduct has two parts, the uterus and the vagina part. Then comes the female genital aperture. Female genital aperture is this, which opens into a chamber which is referred to as the brood pouch. Spermatheca, it has two irregular branches, the prominent left spermatheca and the reduced right spermatheca. The left spermatheca is larger and it stores the sperms. This part, the right spermatheca, is non-functional. Then comes the collyteral glands. Collyteral glands are a pair of glands that lie in the last three or the four abdominal segments. Left is larger than the right collyteral glands. They open by separate chambers and their secretion forms the egg case or ootheca. They open into the brood pouch. This brood pouch is formed by the 7th, 8th, and 9th sterna of the female. Their roof is formed basically by the 7th sterna. Wall and floor is formed by the 8th and the 9th sterna. Wall and the roof is formed by the 8th and the 9th sterna, and the floor is formed by the 7th sterna. The brood pouch has two parts, the interior genital chamber, this, and the posterior oothecal chamber, where the ootheca is formed. Then gonopophysis. These are the phallomeres which are present in the case of female cockroaches. They are the interior gonopophysis, which belongs to the 8th abdominal segment, and the two smaller posterior gonopophysis, these are the smaller, which belongs to the 9th abdominal segment. They serve to hold the ova as they are laid and egg case is formed around them. They act as external genitalia or ovipositor in case of female. The ovaries basically produces eggs and the mature eggs moves to this region. These eggs are released whenever the spermatozoa enters into the female reproductive tract, they are stored into the spermatheca, this left spermatheca. When the mature eggs enter through the oviduct into the common oviduct region, this region, these sperms then unite with this eggs and results in the formation of the zygote. They then enter into the genital, female genital aperture into the brood pouch. In the brood pouch, they meet the secretion of the collateral glands, and as a result, these eggs get covered by the egg case, which is referred to as ootheca. This is the egg case of the cockroach. In this, 16 eggs are laid, one from each ovaries. These eggs are released alternatively from the right and the left ovaries. So 16 eggs are present in the case of egg case or the ootheca of the cockroach, and these 16 eggs are arranged in 8 in each rows, parallel rows, and these bulges which are seen exterior to the ootheca are the regions which shows the presence of the eggs in these. Basically, it shows the rows of the eggs. So after the act of copulation, the 16 eggs are usually mature at a time, one in each ovarian tubule, and these mature eggs pass into the common oviduct from the left and the right ovaries alternatively. When they enter into the genital chamber, fertilization occurs and this ootheca formation takes place. This ootheca remains attached to the female reproductive system, external genitalia, till a safer place is formed, till it protrudes out completely, and then when it protrudes out, it is left at a very safe place. Until and unless a safe place is formed, the female lemur separates the ootheca from its body. Life history, what happens is that in case of cockroach, the metamorphosis is gradual metamorphosis. The three stages which are present in metamorphosis are egg, nymph, and adult. When the eggs are released, the first stage which emerges out of the eggs are referred to as the nymph. They're exactly similar to the adults, except that they are smaller in size as compared to the adults. Their reproductive organs are not developed and they do not have any kind of fangs. They undergo molting. Molting is basically a growth process in which the cuticle is removed. It is also referred to as ecdysis. And the skin cast off by the nymph is termed as exuvae. This is referred to as exuvae. And the process is referred to as molting, or it is also referred to as ecdysis, which occurs under the influence of the secretion of the ecdysum, which is released by the prothoracic hormone. The interval, that is the first nymph and then the molting takes place, the second nymphal stage or the instar. These stages are referred to as the instar, and the time interval between the two nymphal stages is referred to as the stadium. So the egg case hatches in the first instar or the first nymphal stage, which then undergoes molting and results in the formation of the second nymphal stage or second nymphal instar. The time interval between two is referred to as the stadium. And during this transformation, there is increase in the size and there is also development of the wing pads, which later also increases in size according to as the metamorphosis proceeds. There are 6 or 7 molts and equal number of instars, and after each molt, nymph and its wings pads grows in size. After the last molt, the wings become fully formed and the adult cockroach called the imago is formed. There are 3 stages in the life history, the egg, nymph and imago. And this metamorphosis is referred to as the gradual porometabolus, or metamorphosis. Thank you.